good morning to everyone. And so you heard about our virtual laboratory efforts, and we hope that you, all of you, will actually use that very fruitfully and pass it on to your students. And the idea, of course, is that eventually the students must benefit, and in that sense we are all partners, and I hope we can take it forward. So my session is mostly about how to use simulation in teaching, in particular teaching electronics. And we will be using a simulation platform called SQL, which has been developed at IIT Bombay. And if you are already used to some other simulation tool, that is fine. It's not so much the which simulator you use, it is how you use it. So that is really the idea. How many of you are teaching electronics courses? All of you? How many of you have taught the topic of, let's take a few topics, and let's begin with the topic of resonance. How many of you have taught resonance? RLC resonance? Everybody has taught RLC resonance. Okay. So we will just use it as an example as to see how simulation can be used effectively to improve the understanding that students have of a few topics. Let's take a very simple RLC circuit. Are you all using simulation tools like PSPICE or MATLAB and so on? All right. So you're all familiar with the simulation packages. And simulation is often used because things get too complicated for our mind. But it can also be used extremely effectively for teaching purposes. So let's start with a simple RLC circuit. Okay, so let's just take this voltage source as 1 angle 0. All right. So let's say you have taught this topic. You have taught the students about resonance, resonance frequency, quality, bandwidth, etc. And now we are trying to reinforce their ideas with the help of some simulation tools. Okay. Ideally, you could do this whole thing in the lab, but it doesn't happen because it takes too much effort. So it is very good to do that with simulation tools. All right. So, what is the first thing you will demonstrate with a simulation tool? See that? So, okay. Let's have some values for this L and C. One milliampere, 1 microfarad. Right. Okay. So, what is the first thing you would like to demonstrate with this circuit? Frequency response. And you would like to show them that the frequency, the response peaks at the resonant frequency given by 1 over 2 pi square root LC. Can somebody calculate this for me? Anybody has a calculator? These days your mobiles also have calculators. Can somebody calculate this number? I'm trying to do this in a sort of live mode because then you can do the same thing. So I'll treat you for this purpose as a class of students. And so when you teach, the students will be doing these calculations for you. So can you somebody give me this number? Anybody has a mobile or a calculator? Okay, approximately. So 1 millihenry, 1 microfarad, 1 over 2 pi 10^2 square root of 10^2. Huh? 50 hertz. Sounds too low to me. There's a difference. There is a problem with the order of magnitude. The number is correct. All right. Let's see. What is square root of 10^9?
5 kilohertz.
5 kilohertz. That's right. It should be about 5 kilohertz. Okay, square root 10 is about 3, right? 3 and 2 pi is about 6. So this turns out to be about 5 kilohertz. All right. Okay, so let's do this and actually show that the frequency is 5 kilohertz. In the evening session, you will, I hope most of you will come for that session, although it's in the evening. In that, you will actually learn to use this circuit simulation package, and you can do this example yourself. So let's quickly make up this circuit. I will tell you in more detail how to use the simulator. Right now, I'm just sort of doing it for you. So essentially, you need to pick up components, place them on your canvas. Okay, we have got R, L, and C in place. What do we need? What else do we need? We need a voltage source. Okay, and we need something called ground. Okay, ground actually is required for any circuit simulator to work, because that gives us the reference voltages. That defines the reference. That defines the voltages with respect to a particular node. So let's say we have a ground as well. Then just make the connections. Simple. Alright, if you can do the same, if you are using PSpice already, you can do the same thing with PSpice. The simulation tool is really not an issue. The issue is what you do with it. Alright. Okay, what is the next step? Values. Values. Okay. So let me make this amplitude as 1, and frequency we are going to vary, so it doesn't matter. Let me make this, okay, let me make it as 1 ohm right now, and later we'll see if we can change that. L, 1 millihenry. C, 1 microfarad. All right, so now our circuit is ready. In this particular simulator, you need to inform the simulator as to what you want to record. Okay, so that is done by, let me also name these components. Okay, I named these as R, L, C, and B, S. Okay. Now let's include some output variables. And what is the output variable we would like to look at? It's basically the response in this case is the current, right? So, and the current is the same through all of them. So we can look at the current through any of these things. Let me choose the resistor. And there is an output AC variable called I1 AC, okay, of the resistor. So let me put that here. Okay, so that is my output variable. All right, so now the description of this circuit is complete. And now I can go to the so-called solve section. Okay. Now we have defined the circuit. Now we need to tell the simulator what it is that you want to do. Right. You want to do a transient analysis, AC simulation, DC simulation, and so on. That is done by defining a solve block. Right. So in this case, we are interested in AC simulation, frequency domain response. So let's make that AC simulation. All right. In AC simulation, one thing we're going to do is to vary the frequency. We are expecting a frequency, cutoff frequency of 5 kilohertz, so we should vary the frequency from, let's say, 10 hertz to 100 kilohertz, so that we can see a peak. So that is done by a statement called vary frequency. If you have any questions, please stop me at any time. Okay, now you see that there is something called vary type, and that says linear. Whenever you change frequency, it should always be changed in logarithmic fashion. Otherwise, it gets compressed. Otherwise, all the points will get concentrated towards the high frequency. Okay, so let me put, and let me make this a number of, the number of points fairly large, 500. All right, now we are going to change the frequency from 10 hertz to 100 kilohertz logarithmically with 500 points. So that defines this particular, what next? We need to define an output file, and that is done by the output block. And we need to select some output variables. Now since our output variable is a AC type of variable, we can select phase or magnitude as the output to be written to a file. Okay? As you make the changes on the right hand side, things will change also in the center window. Okay, so with that, our description is now complete, and we can now run this program. One more thing we can do is we can display these properties on the canvas. Just take a minute. Okay, so that we know what is what. So we have an R of 1 ohm, we have an L of 1 milli, and we have a C of 1 micro. Can you see all of, can you all see? Can you now see? Okay. All right, better now. Okay. All right, and these things are dynamic. So suppose I change a property of this inductor, that will reflect in the label. Okay, so now we are ready to run the program. If you run the program, if the program is successful, you will see a message here at the bottom called program completed. And the menu will automatically shift to this graphs, the middle one, okay, because that is what the user will typically like to do. So then select the output file, select an x-axis. The middle one is the x-axis, the right one is the y-axis. Y-axis, we will choose the magnitude of the current. Okay, and then let's graph this. Now this is not fitting in your, this is a laptop, so the resolution is not, is a slight problem. This window should really be fitting into your center window. But can you see the resonance? Right. This is of course not the best way of doing it, because whenever there is a frequency involved, you should always use the log scale. So let's do that. Now there is a frequency response. Is it 5 kilohertz? It is 5 kilo. This is 1000 hertz, 10,000 hertz. And so let's expand that part so that you can see better. All right, now you can see better. So this is about 5 kilohertz. Right? 5 kilohertz. Right. Okay, so this, if you are teaching students and if you show such an example, the students immediately get in their head that there is such a thing called peak and resonance and so on. And soon after you cover the theory, they immediately try to connect to what you're doing in class. What else would you like to show them? What happens if I change the value of R? For example, if I make R, go from 1, right now it is 1 ohm. Suppose I make it 2 ohms. What will happen to that? What will happen to the curve? We all know that the resonance frequency itself will not change. 1 over LC, that is independent of, but the bandwidth or the sharpness or the quality will change. So the bandwidth is given by, for this circuit, it is given by R over L. So if you increase the resistor, the bandwidth will increase by a factor of 2. And the quality is given by the resonance frequency by the bandwidth. So in effect, the bandwidth will increase and the quality will decrease. So in other words, the sharpness will decrease. In other words, the circuit will become less selective. So let's see if that happens. I'll go back to the circuit editor. Okay, so I have changed this R to 2. And now let me run the program again. And let's replot. Okay, so actually the data is there, but it has got sort of most of it is overlapping here, so you can't really see. So let's expand this part, see what we get. Okay. Now it's clear that, now can you see the quality is, right? The sharpness has decreased. Right? So, all right, so that is, of course, you do see a problem here. That these problems, the points actually they are not enough. So we need to increase the number of points. See, right now you have a data point here and you have a data point here, but you would really like to have some more points in between. Okay, so let's increase that number and repeat the simulation. Okay, now it's looking better. Okay, so it's these kinds of things are just they will depend on the problem. How many number of points is enough and so on, and of course you can get a visual sort of feedback from the plot that you see. All right, so that is just one part of resonance circuits. Okay, and this is what we mostly teach in our classes. Right, there are a lot of hidden things which we teach, but they don't quite come out. What else can you see in this circuit which will improve the understanding of the student? Can you check on the bandwidth? We have the data, we can see what the bandwidth is, right? So let's do that. So what is the expected bandwidth and what is the bandwidth we are actually getting? So with 2 ohms, our bandwidth is R over L. And in terms of hertz, I think we'll have to how much? 2K. This is 2 ohms, L is 1 millihenry. 2K will get divided by 2 pi, right? So 2K by about 300 hertz. Okay, so 300 hertz means if we are plotting the frequency response like this, okay, this whole thing is 300 hertz, right? So we should have 5 kilohertz minus about 150 hertz, 5k minus 150 hertz, and 5k plus 150 hertz. So that is, those are our 3 dB points. So that is where the response should turn out to be, 1 over square root 2 times I max. 1 over square root 2 is about 0.7. And I max in this case is, what is I max? I max is 1 divided by 2 ohms, right? So one, this is 1 angle 0 volts. So this will turn out to be about 0.7 by 2, 0.35. Okay, so when the current becomes 0.35 ampere, the frequency should be about 4.85 kilohertz and 5.15 kilohertz. Okay, so let's check this. Let's check whether this is actually happening. And all these things are things that you can do in class live. Absolutely no problem. And that gives the student a lot of confidence. So I have expanded this frequency. So what is the peak that we expect? 0.35 ampere. Sorry, not 0.35. 0.5 ampere, right? So you can see this is 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, 0.4, 0.5. So it is indeed 0.5. That's one thing you can definitely point out. And it is at 5 kilohertz as we expect the frequency. Now our interest is the 1 over square root 2 point, the 3 dB point. And that is at 0.35, right? So 0.35. So these are the points that we are interested in, okay? So we can expand this further and see what we get. So 4.8, 4.9, 4.85, okay. So that's roughly what we expected it to be. And this on this side, 0.35, it's about 5.2, okay. All right. So of course we made a very rough calculation. If you do it precisely, then you'll get better. But certainly the order is correct. Okay, what else would you like to see, show your students? Yeah, XC and XM, that's right. So first, XC and XM, we cannot actually show the impedance itself, but we can show in a simulation setup, we can show the phase of the current. So what will the phase look like? Angle of I. So we know that if omega is small, 1 over j omega c dominates. Is large, and if omega is large, then j omega l dominates, right? So then the current in this case, the first case, the current is, the phasor will go as 1 over 1 angle 0 by 1 over 1 by j omega c. So that will have a phase of 90 degrees, j omega c something. So this has a phase of 90 degrees, and the other extreme, in case 2, you will have 1 over j omega l, and that is a phase of minus 90 degrees. And the phase, of course, at resonance is exactly 0, right? So that is immediate, something that we can show. So let's look at the phase of the current. Okay. So again, let's make the x-axis log axis so that you can see it better. All right, so that is very clear. Low frequencies, the phase is 90 degrees. At resonance, which is somewhere here, the phase should be exactly 0. And at high frequencies, the phase is minus 90, minus 50, minus 100, so minus 90. Right. Okay, so that's something that you can show. And of course, as you change the resistance value, this will become sharper, less sharper, and so on. All right, what else would you like to show the students? Transient analysis, yeah, that's something you can show. We'll do that later. What else? But in the frequency domain itself, there is so much more information that you can show.
Quality factor.
That is sharpness that we already seen. Okay. What about these voltages? VR, VL. This also actually has a lot of information. Right? So we know that as so our current is 1 angle 0 by R. Okay. So what is going to happen to VR? Let's look at the phasor diagram. So this is your imaginary axis, real axis. This is your source voltage, right? Okay, now at resonance, of course, the source voltage and this resistance VR is going to be the same. And at any other point, this is the VR is either going to lag or it is going to lead up to 90 degrees. Okay, so now in this particular situation, let's take this particular case. This is your VR. This is VS. And in this case, your VC is minus J by omega C I. Okay, L will lead, right? VL will lead this, and VC will lag, right? And the resultant of these two will essentially add up with VR and then give you VS. All right, so this phasor diagram, of course, we cannot show with the simulation tool, but we can look at how VR, VS, VC and VL change with frequency. All right, and at a given frequency, you can student will have access to the angles and magnitudes of all of these quantities, so that he or she can sketch the phasor diagram. Okay, so what about VC itself? How will that change? Suppose I plot magnitude of VC as a function of frequency. This is my frequency. So how will this change? As the frequency becomes very small, magnitude is going to become 0. As the frequency becomes very small, the magnitude is going to become Vs, right? As the magnitude, all of this, if omega is small, this 1 over j omega c is going to be very large, and all of this will essentially just drop across the. All right, so we already have two data points. At very low frequencies, we have Vc equal to Vs. At very high frequencies, we have Vc equal to 0. What about F0? That is the part that many students have not understood, is in my experience. Okay, so now let us deal with that part. What happens at F0? Greater than Vs. How much greater? Quality factor. That's right. Okay. Now these are things that I find that students don't quite understand. But if you show them a plot like the one that we're going to see, they will immediately remember this all their life. Okay. So Vc at resonance is equal to VL at resonance, and it is equal to Q times Vs. This is a very well-known result, very easy to derive, a nice result. And Q is, in our case, what is Q? Q is omega 0 by bandwidth, and in our case the omega 0 is 1 over 2 pi 1 over square root, let's not worry about this 2 pi, 1 over square root LC divided by R over L. Yes. Okay, so this is going to be 1 over R square root L by C, that is the quality factor, and let's calculate it in our case. 1 over R, R is 2 ohms, L is 1 milli and C is 1 micro. So 1 over 2, 1 milli by 1 micro, square root 10 times 10, right. So this is about, square root 10 is about 3, right, 3 by 2, 1.5, so about 15, right. So actually if you look at this plot, this is, if this is Vs, this is going to be much larger than Vs at F0. So if you plot it versus frequency, you will get something like this. Suddenly it shoots up at, and then it becomes, at some point it becomes 0. Okay. All right. Now this is a very, very important point. People don't realize that there are such huge voltages at resonance across the capacitor and the inductor. Let's look at this. So to do this, we need to add some more variables to our circuit. Okay, and that is done by using some more additional elements. Okay, let me just name name these nodes. Okay, let me tell you what I am doing. I got these voltmeters. Okay, each one of these is actually connected to these points, but the connections are not being shown, otherwise it will look very messy. So they are being assigned the same names so that the connections are there internally but not shown explicitly in the circuit diagram. Okay, so and also let me add the variables that those go with this. So one of these voltmeters is actually connected here, this is connected here, this is connected here. So now we need to add output variables, which is a voltage of this, voltage of that and voltage of that, and that will give us VR, VC and VL and VC. Oh no, this actually, this will not do it. This one does not have the AC part. So let me, what I'll do is I'll just open an existing circuit so that it saves us some time. Okay, this is the one I wanted. So this circuit is ready made and it is already made up. Let me change the values suitably like we have. Okay. This measures the resistor voltage, that measures the inductance voltage and that measures the capacitor voltage. And all these variables are already defined as the output variables. You can see that here. VRAC is defined as the output voltage of this element and so on. Let's run this. Okay, so now I'm plotting VR. Okay, let's plot actually all of this together, see what we get. Or let's just plot the inductance first. Or the, what we are looking at, capacitor, right? Capacitor. Okay, now it should be very clear. Okay. So this is one at low frequencies equal to Vs. Then at resonance, which is somewhere here, becomes 16 times. We said 15, but that was approximate. So it becomes about what we expected. And then finally, when the voltage becomes, when the frequency becomes large, it will go to zero. Okay. So this is some. This is a figure which is extremely informative, and it is something that can stick in the student's mind very well. All right. What happens if I change the resistance to 5 ohms? Okay. What will happen to that figure? If I change. So it was 2 ohms. Now I made it 5 ohms. What will happen to that figure? Okay. This point will obviously not change. At very low frequencies, this point will obviously not change. At resonance, now the quality is better or worse. Resistance has increased, the quality has decreased, and therefore you will not get quite as high as 15 or 16. We'll get some. So if you do the, all these things in class, there is a very good chance that the students will sort of remember it, you know, without studying the topic further. There is an excellent chance of that happening. So you can see that the sharpness has decreased and the magnitude has come down. Okay, what about VL? VL should do just the opposite. VL, if the frequency is very small, then VL should be small, a zero. Frequency is large, then the entire voltage is going to come across the resistance, it's going to be one. And in between, at resonance, it will go through a peak. So it should do like this. Something like that. So let's just check it out. Okay, so that's exactly what happens. So omega very small, j omega L is small, the voltage is zero. Finally, it will become one at omega increases considerably, and at resonance it will go through Q times the Vs. Okay. All right. What about phase? Okay. Suppose I want to plot the phase of VL. For example, angle of VL, what will that do? Very high frequencies, the angle should be, what happens at very high frequencies? Very low frequencies, this is like a short circuit, and the capacitance actually will dominate. So the capacitance impedance is minus j omega C, it may be much larger than R, so the phase of this current will be, let's work it out. I can't do all of this in my head. So I will be 1 angle 0 approximately minus j by omega C, right? So it will be minus, it will be plus j omega C. That is I, and your VL is the current times the impedance. So what is the phase? It's minus 180 or 180 depending on how you look at it. Okay. So let's check this. So so in short, we are expecting the phase to go from plus minus 180 to zero at high frequencies. Okay. Okay. So that is exactly what happens. 180 here, and then finally it is. Whether one, is it 180 or minus 180? How should we choose? It's very simple. At resonance, what is the phase of this j omega L? At resonance, what is the phase of IR, the current? Zero. J omega L times I, that's plus 90 degrees. Okay. So at resonance, which is at 5 k somewhere here, the phase will be exactly 90 degrees. All these things you can bring out in class if you are showing an example like this. Okay, so this is not really about teaching resonance as such, but how to use a simulation tool to improve the students' understanding. So let's take some other example, not related to resonance, but something else. Let's say diodes. You would have all done examples like this in your courses. Okay, so there is a simple diode circuit, two diodes. This is my input voltage and this is my output voltage. Let us take some numbers for these, let us say this is 2 volts. Let's say this is 1k, 2k, 0.5k. Okay, and let's say that these diode voltages, diodes have a drop of 0.7 volts when they conduct, like we typically do. All right. So the student is asked, what would you ask the student to do in this case? We will ask you, ask him to do several things. One, plot VO versus VI. That is always the step number one. And then once the student has got this, then we can ask him or her to plot, you know, the output voltage. If the input is sinusoidal or triangle, then what happens and so on. But the key really is this VO versus VI. All right. So D1 conducts. If Vin is greater than 2.7. D2 conducts if Vin is less than 0.7, minus 0.7. So we mark these points. Let's say this is our 1 volt, minus 1 volt, plus 1, 2, and so on. Okay, so we mark these points, 2.7. Let me extend this axis. 2.7 is somewhere here. Minus 0.7 is here. All right, in between, neither this diode conducts nor this diode conducts, and of course there is no voltage drop across this resistor, and in VO will be equal to V in, and so that is the first thing that we can sketch. So there you between these two points, we will have a straight line which goes through the origin. All right. Beyond this, what happens? Then when D1 starts conducting, you then write this current, ID1 is equal to V in minus 2.7 by R0 plus R1, etc. Right? And then you calculate this VO. All right. So what it will do is essentially it will cause a change in slope at this point. So the slope was 1 earlier, and at this point the slope will change. Similarly, similar things will happen here, and the slope will change. All right, so that is roughly what the student should see. If you actually simulate this circuit, and or if you go to the lab and hook up this circuit. What is the slope? R1 divided by R1 plus R0. So how much?
One third.
This slope R2 divided by, so it's 0.5 by 2.5, right? 1 by 5. Okay. So if we look at the graph carefully, we should be able to see all of these details. So let's do this. I will use a very simple diode model here, which has got a large off resistance and a small on resistance. Okay, so let us make the on resistance 1 milli ohm and off resistance let us say 10 mega ohms, very small, very large. Okay, and then we will copy this into another diode. Okay, now we need resistors. Okay, and also we need a voltage source. Huh? We need one more resistance, that's right. Okay, I need a DC voltage source and of course I need a ground. Okay, now in this for this source, the input source, we can actually use a AC source, because then we will be able to see all that result as well. So let's call that VCR, say AC. All right, now we can quickly do the wiring. Now these are things you can either assign as a homework to the students, or you can just do it in class, because it really doesn't take much time. And if there is a problem with time, you can always make up these yourself and just run the examples in front of the students in class. Okay, so that's it. So this was 2K. Let me also write these values here, so for our reference. Okay. So let me call this D1. This D2, and these things have got a parameter called the on voltage, on. So we will put that as 0.7 volt. Now this AC source, all right, one question is, this is our V in and this is our V out. So we need something to measure this output voltage. So naming the nodes is not really important or not really required, but I often like to do it, because what else? Okay, we need to set this voltage at 2 volts. That's it. And this input voltage, we can let this go from minus 5 volts to plus 5 volts, so an amplitude of 5 volts. And a frequency, frequency really doesn't matter, because we are only going to look at it as a sort of low frequency DC circuit. So let me make the amplitude 5, and let me make the frequency, let's say 50 hertz. All right, so let me what all do we want to see? That's the next thing we need to worry about. What would you like to see? Definitely, we would like to see this input voltage, output voltage. What else would you like to see? Simulation, the good thing is you can see a lot of things. In lab, it's not always possible to see everything. So what is, from the student's perspective or to from the point of his understanding, what would be a good thing to see in this circuit? Apart from diode conduction. So the student would like to see when exactly this diode starts conducting, when exactly this starts conducting, because that is the basis of our calculation. So it's good to see these diode currents. So let's add all these variables. One is the input voltage here, V1, output voltage, diode current. Okay, and let me name these things. Okay, so that's it. All right, so now the next step is what you want to do with this circuit. Okay, and what we want to do with this circuit is, now this is a time varying source, so we should really do a transient simulation, not a DC simulation. Okay, so let's go back to solve blocks, add a solve block and change that to transient. Okay, as soon as you change it to transient, you will need to fill up these details, like what is the starting time, what is the ending time, what is the delta t. T end, let's simulate for just 2 cycles, which is 40 milliseconds, because the frequency is 50 hertz. Delta t constants, let's say a small number like 0.01 millisecond. And in transient simulation, you need to choose a method. You will learn more about this when you read the manual and so on. So So let me choose the backward Euler method. Okay, this is a very simple linear problem, not linear problem, but it's a very simple problem with a simple diode model. So there should not be a problem with convergence and so on. Then we have an output block. In output block, we will include the variables Vs, Vout, ID1, and ID2. Okay, that should do it. Okay, so the program has completed, and I hope it things have worked. So first thing we would like to see is what is the output voltage as a function of. That is the input voltage, that is the output voltage, and let us see what that looks like. Okay, so that is indeed what you would expect. Let's check this out. Much better. So this is minus 0.7, right? This is 0, minus 1, so minus 1, minus 0.7, 2, 3, 2.7, and that is a slope of 1, okay, that you can make out from the axis. And then this slope, what is this slope? It should be 1 by 5, is it 1 by 5? 1 by 3. So in other words, if I go 3 here, okay, the axes are different. Let me expand it. Now it's better. Okay. So in other words, if I go from 1 by 3, right? Okay. If I go from 3 to 3.3, I should go by 0.1 there, right? So is that happening? 3 to 3.3. And from here to here is 0.1, 1 by 3. Similarly, the other slope should be 1 by 5. That is the other slope. So if I go from here to here, this, I should go here from there to there by 1. So this is 0.5, and this is, well, let's, it should be 1.5. You can verify that. So you can show all these things in class. All right, so that is not all. We would also like to see the diode currents, right? That's very important. Let me plot the diode current ID1 versus Vs. And that is what we would expect. The diode 1 starts conducting at 2.7 and otherwise is 0. Diode 2 will start conducting at minus 0.7. And then it is, then it conducts at that point. 0, minus 1, so this is minus 0.7. Okay. So all of these things, if the students actually sees these in the class, you know, definitely has a good impact on the student, and things stay in the mind. Because the picture is always worth a lot. All right, what else would we, can we see? Now, since we have this, since we have a time-varying source, we can actually see the time-varying output. So this is an input AC source, so we should be able to see some clipping kind of thing. So let's look at things with respect to time. So that's the, this is when the slope is 1, and then the input and output should be exactly equal, and this is where the slope is 1 by 3 and 1 by 5. Diode currents, that's the diode currents. So this is where diode 2 is conducting, and that is where diode 1 is conducting. And you can of course look at these things together with the input voltage and so on to make sense out of it. Okay, what else do you teach in basic electronics? Thevenin circuits. Let's look at a Thevenin circuit example. All right, let's look at a Thevenin equivalent problem. I see many familiar faces in the audience. I've seen you before. I've seen some other people. Okay, so we want to reduce this circuit in to this form. Let's take some number, 10 volts, 2 ohms, 6 ohms. Okay. A very simple circuit, actually you can show many more complicated circuits. But the point is, how do you use a simulation tool to show this Thevenin equivalent resistance? Any idea? You used PSPICE before, right? So normally the simulation packages will not give you the Thevenin and Thevenin voltage or resistance directly. So how do you go about it? Okay, so the answer is very simple. All right, so this circuit and this circuit are the same, and now suppose I connect a voltage source here. Okay, an external voltage source called V0, right? And I look at this current, I0, and suppose I plot VO versus I0. What will that give me? That will give me a straight line. Let's see what the equation is. Very simple. VO is V Thevenin plus I0 times RTH, if my signs are correct. Yeah? Okay. I0 itself is V0 minus VTH by RTH. No, wait. That is not what I want. I want VO versus I0. So this is it, right? So VO versus I0 is a straight line, VO versus IO. X-intercept will be equal to VTH. Y-intercept will be V. Y-intercept will be VTH, yeah, when I0 is 0, okay, and when VO is 0, minus VTH by RTH, right, okay, somewhere here, VTH by RTH, okay, so I should get a straight line, which looks like this. Okay, let me do better than that. Let me plot it against this current. Let's say I prime. So this is VTH minus I prime times RTH. Okay, so in this case, I'll get VO versus I prime. So now the only difference is the direction of the current is defined like that. So now the y-intercept is the same. X-intercept is positive, right? Did I make a mistake? VO equal to, that's right. So now it's the same straight line, except it is a mirror image of that one. All right, so in other words, we can get from this figure V Thevenin immediately. Just look at this number, and what is actually this thing called? It's nothing but the short circuit current or the Norton, right? Norton equivalent. Okay. So in our case, in this example, if I plot this, if I make a plot like this, what should I get for VTH? In this example, 2.5. So I should get a VTH of 2.5, and I should get a Norton current or a short circuit current of 10/6. And from these, of course, I can get the resistance. So 10/6 is 1. 1.67 ampere. And of course, the Thevenin resistance in this case it is just 2 parallel 6, which is 1.5 ohms. And that should be also equal to this ratio, 2 by 8 into 10 divided by 10 by 6 is the same thing. Okay. So several ways of looking at it. So, but the key is, if you are using a simulator, then you can produce a plot like this, and from this, this plot has got all the information that you need about the Thevenin circuit. So let's do this simple problem. Okay, so that is the circuit we are looking at. This is 6 ohms. And this is 10 volts. Okay, and the output variables that we would like to see is the current through this source, but I want to define it like this. So let me just put an ammeter there. Okay, and we are going to look at this voltage as a function of this current. So let me put those as output variables, this voltage here and this current here. Okay, so very simple circuit. Okay, so let me go to the solve blocks. This is a DC simulation, and we are going to vary a parameter. What parameter are we going to vary in this? We are going to vary the input voltage, so we can get many points. Okay, so let me just call this some name, PS. Okay, solve block vary parameter. So element is VS. Parameter is VDC values. Let's say we want to go from 0.5 to 1 volt. How should we choose this range? VThevenin is 2.5, so definitely this VThevenin should be more than, let's see, well, let's just go from some number to some number, and if we don't get enough of this, then we will change that. Output block. So that should be enough, solve this. So our x axis should be I0 and y axis should be V0. Okay, and this happens sometimes when you make mistakes. So we have made a mistake somewhere. The mistake is actually I should be varying the output the voltage of this source and not this source. Okay, this is a constant. So that I made that mistake there. And we do have this. So this is our x-axis. This is our y-axis, right? And let me just blow up this part. So that the short circuit current and the open circuit voltage, which is the same as the Thevenin voltage, this is the same as VTH by RTH. Let us read out these values. So what is the open circuit voltage? This is our 0, 0. 2. 2.67, is it? You should get 2.5. Well, it should be exactly 2.5. So this is 2.5. And the short circuit current is should be 1.67. 1.67. If you want to plot this in more, read it more accurately, you can always blow up this part. Now you can see that this is 1.667. Okay. So we are getting exactly what we wanted, 1.67. What is the next thing you can teach the students? Next thing is after, so we will get from this the Thevenin resistance equal to 1.5 and Thevenin voltage equal to 2.5. Now we can ask the student that you connect, instead of this whole thing, we can connect a resistance. And if I connect a resistance of let's say 2.5 ohms, what should this current be? Okay, so that is a problem that we can pose to the students. So the answer is very simple. This circuit is the same as this circuit is the same as 2.5 volts here, R Thevenin 1.5, and then this is 2.5. All right. So this current then should be 2.5 by 4. Should be 0.625. So this is an exercise that the student can check out. So we'll just quickly do this. How do we do this? Just remove this source, remove this ammeter, and connect a resistor here. As simple as that. Okay. What is the value of this resistance? 2.5 ohms. Okay. And let's add this output variable, the current of this resistor, I1. Okay. I'll figure it out later. Now we are running out of time. But anyway, that is what we can show the students. We can figure out the current, then that will be good. Okay, so I just wanted to give you a little tour of the various examples that are already there. You are welcome to use these examples. And they are in several directories. There's a directory called BJT circuits, digital circuits, diode circuits, E101 is a course that we teach here. There are a lot of circuits there. Electronics, general, some MOS circuits, op-amp circuits. Power electronics, power systems, I guess is not relevant here. Solar cells, and so on. So if you are teaching any course in op-amp, there are lots of circuits in op-amps as well. So you know what this is? What is this circuit? Yeah? This is an integrator and this is a Schmitt trigger. It's a square wave generator, it's square wave or triangle wave generator. So let's look at some of these results. Okay, if you look at this output, you should see a triangle wave. If you look at this output, you should see a square. So that is what we will see. And why is it not symmetric? I mean, why is this not symmetric around zero? It's because there is an offset voltage. Okay, there is an offset voltage here. If you make this zero, then it will also go. So all these things are very easy to show in class with the help of simulation. What is this? Some of you would be teaching this. This is a simple current mirror, and this is a reference current, and that reference current gets mirrored on. This is a very simple one, and it is not a very good one because it has got a variation in the output current because of the voltage here. So if you plot this current as a function of this voltage, it will not be quite constant. So that is, so let's just plot that. Okay, so that is what, so this is the reference current on the left hand side, and this is the mirrored current. So you can see that the mirrored current is not quite constant. There are things you can do to improve this, and you can make a cascode connection and so on. So I'll just show you quickly that as well. Okay, so this is the so called cascode connection, and if you look, if you do the same thing in this one, if I plot this current as a function of this voltage here, then things should be, it should be much more constant. So let me plot all four transistor currents, and you can see that the variation is not even visible on this scale. Here of course things go wrong because the transistors will enter saturation and so on. But that anyway you are not supposed to operate in this regime. Okay. So these advantages you can bring out with the help of simulation. Otherwise you do all this theory and then students not sure whether they understand or not, and then they have not seen any pictures. So they go back not knowing exactly how it works. There are some digital circuits. You are familiar with this circuit? It's an up-down counter, simple up-down binary counter. There is an up, there's a mode input which goes to all of these circuits, and then there is a mode bar input. And depending on whether mode is 1 or 0, you count up or down and so on. These are things which are difficult to draw on the board. So instead of drawing on the board, you can just show a simulation result. So that is what it looks like. That's the clock, Q0, Q1, Q2, Q3. Okay, I think our time is up. So we'll stop here. In the evening, we have an extra session. It's outside your schedule, in which you are welcome to learn to use the simulator and then try out some circuits. Okay, thank you.